Welcome back. More earnings, more numbers and more corporate conversations. Mannapuram Finance has had a decent third quarter. There's been good growth coupled with improvement in net interest margins. We have Mr. VP Nandakumar, MD and CEO of Mannapuram Finance, now joining us for a quick chat. Thanks for joining us, sir. Now, what sort of one gauges at first glance is that the gold loan business seems to be doing okay. It's some of the other segments which are really beginning to fire up. First up, if you could confirm this, I picked this up from a note that on the gold loan side, have you reduced your growth guidance from 15% to 10%? How much have you done on the gold loan business this quarter? And what is the outlook for the whole year in terms of growth in that book?
Yeah, in gold loan, from the third quarter last year to third quarter this year, we have grown by 10.6%. So, but this year, so far we have grown slightly over 6%, but we hope we may reach around 10% towards the end of this fiscal. So, it is not due to the demand has come down. It is primarily due to the redemptions happening on account of festivals, so many other things, etc., etc. The dispersals are seen more. I think towards the end of this quarter, we may be able to reach 10%.
Okay, so you're looking at reaching 10% by the end of Q4 in terms of gold loan growth.
Right.
What about the microfinance business, Mr. Nandakumar? Over there, it's been a good growth that you've seen both in vehicle financing, even housing financing and the MFI business. So tell us, what are the growth expectations here over the next few quarters?
Current monthly disbursals are around 400 crores in microfinance. Mm-hmm. We expect to cross the AUM of microfinance to over 3,500 crores. That's our expectation, and the quality remains very good. The recovery rate is over 99.5%. It is doing good. The OPEX is one of the lowest in the industry. It is slightly over 6%. Hopefully in another few quarters it will come down below 6%. Lending rate also, because our average borrowing cost is lower compared to the industry, so we lend below 21%. That also is a factor which can give comfort to the borrowers. Mm.
Speaking of borrowing costs, actually, how did the cost of money shape up for you in the last 3 months? Because this was a challenging quarter, a lot of issues in the credit market. Did you also take rate hikes? Did you pass it on to your customers? What should we expect on margins as we end the year?
So the borrowing cost is up by 48 bps. So, as our average borrowing in gold loan is around 75 days, and also small ticket, we could pass on that to the customers. Microfinance also, we have whatever is the increase, we have passed on. So, in commercial vehicle also, as we are in the used vehicle finance business, is passed on to the customer. So now we get now incremental short-term borrowing cost is coming down. It is a CP. Yeah, we are able to raise at 8%, which has gone up to even over 9%. Similarly, the bank funding also, we are negotiating with the banks, etc., etc. So we hope that now already we reached the peak. The chances are for it to coming down in the coming quarters.
Okay. Just one final word on this microfinance business. You spoke about a 400 crore run rate. But in terms of, the quality of the assets, are you expecting to see any delays in terms of recoveries? Because is there still stress in the MFI space? Because that was what we heard the last time we spoke to you.
No, there is no stress. Demand, there was stress. We have fully written those off, whatever is the stress, etc. Our policy is to fully write off accounts where the overdues are more than 120 days. Our write off policy and provisioning policy is even more rigorous than the regulatory mandate. So we continue to do that. Our portfolio quality remains very high. We have distributed our presence across the country. In northern state, our AUM is more than 10%, other than Tamil Nadu. Tamil Nadu, because of the legacy, the portfolio is around 25%, which is gradually coming down.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Okay. Unfortunately, running a little short on time, but thank you very much, sir, for giving us some details in the quarter gone by at Mannapuram. By the way, now this increase in guidance on comments is not a surprise because this company already was ahead of its guidance in 9 months of the year itself. They've done so well. It's been such a strong quarter for comments. So perhaps it was just an obvious sort of statement to raise the guidance because they've done 12-month guidance in 9 months. Already. So now we have a new figure coming in from Cummins. Let's quickly move on to the commodity universe then. We have Manisha joining us with all the action in the currency and commodity space. How's it looking this morning, Manisha?
Hi, Surbhi. Thank you for that. Well, the crude oil prices have continued to decline for a second straight day. Well, yesterday was a weaker day as well. And this is reaction to the U.S. weekly inventory numbers that came in yesterday. There has been a buildup in inventories in U.S. yet again. If you look at the U.S. production, that's at a record high week-on-week basis at 11.9 million barrels per day. And that clearly is pulling the prices down. The only thing that you haven't seen a complete sell-off and the crude prices in the international market still holding those key levels is that the markets are looking at the OPEC supplies continue to be cut. And you also are looking at the concerns arising out of crisis in Venezuela. That, of course, is leading to some support in the prices. But it is the strength in U.S. dollar, and that is weighing on not just crude oil prices, but the other commodities as well. The gold and silver price is under pressure because of that. And we've broken below that key resistance or rather support level of 40,000 in silver, more than 0.5% down on both of those precious metals on your screens. The global prices also have been under pressure. The major focus of this market now would be the U.S. and China trade talks in the next week as is being scheduled. Some of the safe haven buying seems to be getting out of the precious metal prices because of the strength in dollar and, of course, the financial concerns easing a bit. The base metal prices in the meanwhile have been all over the place. Well, we did see gains yesterday. We haven't been able to hold on to them, especially for copper, which still actually continues to hold very close to those 2 month highs. Remember, we are looking at a copper deficit in supplies for most of this quarter and the next as well. And that has been supportive. Ditto is the case with all the other metals as well. You have lead prices trading at multi-month highs. Nickel is at a 4 month high. Zinc trading at a 7 month highs as well. The prices have been gaining one because there is a force majeure that has been declared by a whale on some contracts in iron ore, and that has been supportive for all of these steel ingredients as well. Apart from that, it also has to do with the decline in supplies on LME and Shanghai warehouses. There are deficit concerns, especially for lead. There also are reports coming in that China, to crack onto their environment concerns, could actually be curbing output going forward in case of lead. And that clearly has been supportive for that. But this space also will keep an eye on the US and China trade talks in the next week. And further direction, of course, would come in from there. Trading strategies, and we have them from Angel. It's a buy call across sectors. For gold, they're looking at upside targets of 33,400. It also continues to be a buy in case of crude from them. 3980 is what they're watching. And copper as well continues to be a buy. They're looking at levels of 455 on that one today.
Okay, thanks a lot for those commodity strategies. We take a short break on that note, but we're not done with earnings corner just yet. On the other side of the break, B. Venkatesh Rao, the MD of Venkis India, will join in to talk about their quarterly numbers. Stay tuned.